Spaceship Earth Control. On behalf of Stevens, welcome aboard. On the map in front of you, please show us where you're from while we input your time travel coordinates. Now locate the monitor overhead to the right. Make sure your face is clearly visible and wait for the flash. Good. Sending photo to the future. All systems are go. Linking you now to your guide.
Like a grand and miraculous spaceship, our planet has sailed through the universe of time. And for a brief moment, we have been among its passengers. But where are we going? And what kind of future will we discover there? Surprisingly, the answers lie in our past. Since the dawn of recorded history, we've been inventing the future one step at a time. So, let's travel back in time together. I'll show you how our ancestors created the world we know today. And then it will be your turn to create the world of tomorrow. Here, in this hostile world, is where our story begins. We are alone, struggling to survive, until we learn to communicate with one another. Now we can hunt as a team and survive together. It takes 15,000 years to come up with the next bright idea, recording our knowledge on cave walls. There was only one small problem. When we moved, the recorded knowledge stayed behind. Now let's move ahead to ancient Egypt, because something is about to happen here that will change the future forever. This unknown Egyptian pounding reeds flat is inventing papyrus, a sort of paper. Papyrus, in turn, creates better record-keeping of plans, designs, and unfortunately, taxes. But it also brings with it the dawn of great civilizations. At this point, each civilization has its own form of writing, which none of the others can understand. But the Phoenicians, who trade with all of them, have a solution. They create a simple common alphabet, adaptable to most languages. Remember how easy it was to learn your ABCs? Thank the Phoenicians. They invented them. The ancient Greeks were great inventors of the future. First, they establish public schools, and then begin teaching an intriguing new subject called mathematics. And with math comes mechanical technology and the birth of the high-tech life we enjoy today. With lessons learned from the Greeks, the Romans create a powerful empire. To move their armies around, they build a system of roads all over the known world. Rome built the first World Wide Web. And it's leading us into the future. But then we hit a roadblock. Rome falls, and the great library of Alexandria in Egypt is burned. Much of our learning is destroyed, lost forever. Or so we think. It turns out there are copies of some of these books in the libraries of the Middle East, being watched over by Arab and Jewish scholars. Call it the first backup system. The books are saved, and with them our dreams of the future. In the meantime, here in Europe, monks toil endlessly recording books by hand. But that is about to change. In 1450, Gutenberg invents the movable type printing press. Now knowledge can travel as fast as these new books, and travel they do. Books make it easier to invent the future in every field. And the result is an incredible explosion of innovation we call the Renaissance. By now, we're all communicating from anywhere on Earth, and in 1969, from somewhere else.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
To send a man to the moon, we had to invent a new language, spoken not by man, but by computers. At first, very large, very expensive computers, but we see the potential. What if everyone could have one of these amazing machines in their own house? There's just one problem. They're as big as a house. The solution comes in, of all places, a garage in California. Young people with a passion for shaping the future put the power of the computer in everyone's hands. After 30,000 years of time travel, here we are, a truly global community, poised to shape the future of this, our spaceship Earth. have some fun creating the future, shall we? On your computer screen, answer a few questions for us. Then we'll show you a new world, custom made just for you. Ready? Well done. Now, along with your answers, let's add in some amazing new technology that we happen to know about. And now I believe your future is just about ready. Let's take a look, shall we?
Welcome to the future. Or should I say, your future. Here in your future, getting away on vacation is a breeze. Your smart suitcase knows where you're going and what you'll need. And with solar power from your home fueling station, you won't have to worry about your pets while you're gone, thanks to handy household robots. You'll leave your city home in an ultra-light, ultra-powerful, totally networked family car that can take you anywhere. You've already planned the trip with your virtual travel agent. Hotels, check. Restaurants, check. Guided tours, check. Getting there is half the fun, so your family car will be equipped with virtual tools to teach you about the world outside your window. You'll travel quickly and safely to places you can't imagine visiting today. And the moment you arrive at your ultimate vacation destination, you can dive right in to the future. The end, or should I say the beginning, of your future.
So here's to the next 30,000 years on spaceship Earth. While no one knows for sure what we'll see or do, an adventure that we'll take and make together.
Welcome to our special drive-through open house. I'm Dr. Michael Channing, Chairman of the Imagination Institute.
Hello. On your tour, you'll see how the five human senses can help capture your imagination.
Can I go too?
Absolutely not. This is one of our discoveries, the figment of imagination.
Yeah, I know all about the senses. There's sight, sound, smell, touch, goochie goochie go, and
out of my sight.
Out of sight? Okay. Come on, everybody. Here we go.
Figment, you are not to interfere with the tour.
Our first stop is the sound lab. We'll begin by testing your hearing with a series of tones. Left ear, right ear. Left, right. What? This is odd. Hello? Who is this?
It's Figment.
Figment? I thought I told you not to interfere.
But you've got it wrong, Doc. It's not about listening with your ears. It's about listening with your imagination.
Now I've completely lost my train of thought.
No, you haven't. It's over here. All aboard.
Continuing now, if I may, in a calm, scientific, figment-free manner, the things we see with our eyes can control the eyes of the imagination. Let's begin by using the eye chart to test your vision. Now, all together, if you would please read line 3 and hear.
You can see things differently. Sure, you can see with your eyes, but imagine what you could see if you used your imagination. Follow the bouncing figment.
What sort of light should light your fancy? Your mind sees more than what your eyes see. Your sense of sight can make your fancy fly.
Say imagination must be captured and controlled.
Imagination works best when it's set free. Just turn your imagination loose and anything can happen.
Figment? Oh, he's gone. Our research shows that smells often trigger the imagination, especially when pleasant, familiar smells come to
us.
This is not a good time.
It's always a good time to use your imagination, so let the good times roll!
Stink in the smell lab. I hesitate to send you into the touch and taste labs. Perhaps I should end my open house right here.
Great idea. We'll go to my open house instead. It's much more fun. Right this way, everybody.
Figment, what is going on? You're turning this entire open house upside down.
Upside down? Now you're talking. That's the best idea you've had all day.
With just a spark of inspiration, I made my house.
So, as you can plainly see, imagination works the best when it's set free.
You said it, Doc! Imagination is a blast!
Right at the start. Welcome to a voyage of discovery and awareness of the richness, the diversity, and the often surprising nature of living with the land. Our journey begins as dramatic and sudden changes are sweeping over the land. The approaching storm may seem violent and destructive to us, but to nature, it's a new beginning in the cycle of life. Beneath the surface of the land, roots trap water from the flowing mud, extracting precious nutrients and minerals. These elements, when combined with sunlight, create the diverse living systems of our planet. One of those living systems is the rainforest, home to the most amazing concentration of life on our planet. These dense and beautiful forests cover only a tiny portion of the Earth's surface, but they contain more than half of its plant and animal species. Rainforests are also extremely rich in productive living systems, providing us with oxygen, food, medicines, and other elements essential to our lives. In the desert, nature has created a very different, but no less beautiful, living system. And while this arid landscape may seem lifeless, it is very much alive. The plants and animals that have learned to survive in these harsh conditions make use of what little water they can find and avoid the scorching rays of the relentless sun. The American prairie once appeared as desolate as the desert, but over time, rainwater and nutrients gradually penetrated the hard surface of this land. Even the hooves of the mighty buffalo helped create the rich soil that would one day become home to the American farm. Of all the forces at work on the land, humans have had one of the most profound effects. The need to produce food for a growing world led to the enormous use and sometimes overuse of the land. In our search for more efficient ways to grow food, we often failed to realize the impact of our methods. Today, we're learning to live with the land, discovering better ways to grow food that will assure both human and environmental well-being.
Crops that thrive on saltwater. Here at Epcot, we're learning to reduce the need for pesticides by using natural predators like ladybugs and wasps to control pests.
How will we meet tomorrow's growing needs for food production, yet still respect the needs of the land? Some of the answers are being discovered just ahead. To help us maintain these carefully controlled ecosystems, and for your safety, please remain seated in your boat at all times. Welcome to our living laboratories, where scientists from Epcot and the U.S. Department of Agriculture are exploring innovative ways to produce bountiful harvests now and into the future. The tropics are home to the greatest diversity of plants on the planet. Many of these, like papaya, bananas, cacao, coffee, and rice, are well known around the world. These are just a few of the edible plants that have been an important source of nutrition for people living in the tropics. Many are rich in vitamins and minerals, while others are well adapted to growing in less than ideal conditions. Some, like the water lily, thrive in wet, swampy areas and waterways. All parts of this plant, even the flower petals, are edible. The starchy root of the plant has long been used to make flour for baking. One day, many of these lesser-known tropical plants may be as important as the bananas growing on both sides of the boat. More than 28 million tons of bananas are eaten annually, making it the most popular fruit in the world. When we mention farming, you probably don't think of fish, but fish farming, or aquaculture, accounts for nearly half of all the seafood consumed globally. Tilapia, bass, and catfish, like the ones you see here, are three of the more popular crops raised by fish farmers. The sustainable system we're using here recycles the water in the tanks. As a result, we're able to save millions of gallons each year. Our small fish farm produces nearly 5,000 pounds of fish each year to serve in restaurants around Walt Disney World. Innovations like this one can play an important role in our efforts to produce bountiful harvests and still protect natural resources. While there are more than 50,000 edible plant species in the world, most of us are only familiar with the handful that make up our everyday diet. The common grains growing here, wheat, maize, sorghum, and millet, plus rice, account for nearly two-thirds of our global food consumption. Learning how to increase yields of these staples is an important goal of research around the world. These plants are definitely on their way up. Innovative growing techniques like these increase yields while more efficiently using resources like water, fertilizer, and pesticides. Another innovation at work here is our integrated pest management program. By populating our greenhouses with beneficial insects that prey on harmful pests like aphids and flies, we are significantly reducing our reliance on conventional pesticides. We're growing these crops using our nutrient film system. This technique precisely controls and recycles water and nutrients. With it, we can produce over 27,000 heads of lettuce a year in this one small area. Some of our best ideas have been inspired by nature, like these fruit and vegetable trees. By growing these ground plants vertically, we can increase yields and better control diseases. These crops taste as good as they look. In fact, we serve more than 15 tons of produce from our greenhouses in restaurants here at the land every year. The future of agriculture may include innovative ideas like this vertical growing system. Plants grown in this way use a fraction of the space required by traditional growing methods. That saves water and increases production. The aquaponics system on your left combines hydroponics with aquaculture. The fish provide a natural source of fertilizer for the plants, and the plants help keep the water clean for the fish. It's another great way to produce more while using less. In our lab, Epcot scientists are working with the U.S. Department of Agriculture on a number of innovative projects. The goal of these efforts is to produce higher yielding and better quality plants. These greenhouses represent just a fraction of the work being done worldwide to produce bountiful harvests for our growing population. Scientists, farmers, and even backyard gardeners are doing their part to improve the quantity and quality of foods that we all rely upon. Together, we can continue to find more ways to increase food production and protect our precious natural environment. Only then will we truly be living with the land. Please gather all your personal belongings. Lower your head and watch your step as you exit.
Don't worry. Just keep your eyes open for him on the way.
Nemo!
Now,
Natch.
Why do?
Nemo! Where are you, Nemo?
Who's Nemo?
He's my son. You know that.
I do.
We went on a huge adventure together.
Is he orange with white stripes and looks kind of like you and his mom?
Yes. Have you seen him?
Seen who?
Ah, jellyfish!
Right. Okay, now I'm thinking of something.
That's jellyfish!
You're good. And I'm thinking...
Jellyfish! And the next one, jellyfish!
All right, Mr. Smarty Pants.
Stop playing games!
Games? I love games!
Thank you. Gee, we are looking for a dog.
Never mind.
What's this? Oh, yes.
While doing walking here, just reminding you to keep your hands and arms, feet and legs inside the boat there, and virtually for what you are.
Oh, 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 oh. Do you want to build a snowman? Come on, I know you do. As he's made a magic wish.
going to show
it's summer snow
for Sven and me and you.
Oh, we're going up to Elsa's ice palace. You and you and you, all of you. See you there.
Once, with Elsa trapped by fear, Anna saved her sister with an unselfish act of true love and thawed a frozen heart.
And now they're best friends.
Indeed.
You're going up to the palace? Lucky.
Anyway.
Winter's a good time to stay in and cuddle, but put me in summer and I'll be a
happy snowman?
Exactly!
When life gets rough, I like to hold on to my dream of relaxing in the summer sun.